Thank you for throwing me the show. Hello, everybody. Welcome, and hopefully you've been enjoying the Baltimore Comic-Con thus far. It's been an incredible show. I've been watching it from beginning to now, and have not missed a thing. Hopefully you haven't either. All right, I got my time. So I guess we'll just hang until everybody's into the chat. And then we'll get going. So I want to welcome everybody into the chat. I want to thank everybody from Baltimore Comic-Con and Mainframe for giving Comic Pop, our little channel that could, an opportunity to show the show. Mitch, thanks for being here, man. How are you?
Howdy. Good.
Good.
Good, good.
Evan, how are you, man?
I'm good.
Good.
I know that guy. I know that guy, too.
Yeah, I'm the odd man out here. And before I start,
wait,
I just want to know
you.
Yeah, right. We've met before, kind of.
We're old friends.
Yeah, very, very, very old. Very good. Mitch Gerads. How do I say your name, man?
I'm sorry. Gerads.
Gerads. All right. Now I can do the smooth intro. Hey, everybody, welcome to the Strange Adventures panel with Mitch Gerads, Tom King, and of course Evan Doc Shaner. Thank you so much for being here, gentlemen.
What a pleasure. Thank you.
Happy to.
Absolutely my pleasure. Hey, I didn't coordinate this, so don't thank me. But I am so thankful to be here and for having you, gentlemen,
my head
here.
Is always not straight.
It might be the camera. You don't
I
know.
Will fudge with my hat the entire time.
Yeah, we'll all put on hats and put them askew. To look
think
like
I hit it.
Part of the video.
There you
perfect.
Go. Nailed it.
I think that's how the kids are wearing them these days. So I think you're definitely on point, guys. So
this is the all hat humor panel. I know that's what you guys turned in for.
This is what we're here for, really. This is the jokes, folks.
Hey, fellow youngsters.
How you do, fellow kids? Man, Strange Adventures is an incredible series that is out right now. Issue 6 just dropped only about a week or two ago. We are halfway through, which means DC must be putting out a hardcover pretty soon. I'm just making a joke at the expense of your employer, so don't mind me. But yeah, so let's talk about how this came about and what everyone's involvement started and your insights into the book. Where did the idea for doing a book about Adam Strange, Mr. Terrific, the war on Ran, all of that, how did that start, and what compelled you to call up these two geniuses to make it happen?
I assume he's talking to Doc, right?
I'm definitely talking to Doc. No.
I mean, I knew I was one of them.
But I had to write. I had to be the other guy. So
yeah.
I'm like process of elimination here,
right?
well, we were like, you know, we looked in the list of most popular DC characters, and
right.
And you were like, we love to sell comics because it feeds our family. We love our family, and we know the more popular character is, the more comics we sold. So then we looked on that list and we picked the person at the very bottom of the list.
Well, we accidentally sorted backwards to top.
Yeah, yeah, right. We pushed the wrong arrow. Or in retrospect, it was like, I put it on alphabetical and just like Adam Strange. Like, oh, he's the
perfect.
One.
You'll get to them eventually. Everyone will get a 12 issue mini. And it's we'll start with A. But yeah, man, so what appealed to you about Adam? Like, well, the book is called Strange Adventures. It's not necessarily about Adam.
It is. No, it's not. It's not an Adam. Adam is one of the three main characters. It's about Adam, Alana, and Mr. Terrific. And even the narrative, as you see, the even issues are Mr. Terrific issues and the odd issues are Adam issues. So he doesn't even get, he only gets half of the narrative structure. Except for Doc. Doc has to draw all Adam because we put him in a little box.
It's just so pretty.
How did it begin? I'm sorry, we've told this origin story so many times, so we always a little feel like people might get bored of it.
That's fair.
So I feel bad saying it, but I mean, no, it's new to someone, and it was revelatory to me. We were in the midst of Mr. Miracle, and we were looking for sort of the next project, and since we're creative, out of the box thinkers. We thought, oh, let's just do Mr. Miracle again, but with a different character. And Mitch is like, is there anyone else who, like, is there another white guy who can be sad? And I was like, this universe has, like, a ton of white guys who can make sad.
Wait, God. Yeah.
Let's look into this. And so, no, we were discussing sort of what to do next. And I had like just a bunch of ideas sort of floating in my head. I wanted to do something that was more about villainy and bad guy stuff, and less Mr. Miracle was so hopeful and heroic. I wanted to do something that was a little more acid. And then I was at Mitch's house for the baptism of his. I was going to say your youngest
child. Still...
Congratulations.
And that was the last time I saw Mitch on purpose. So, in the midst of the ceremony, we're baptizing the child, right? And the priest is saying things, and Mitch is like, wait, I had an idea! And I'm just like, it's not time. The child is renouncing sin. And we went on Mitch's shelf, and we literally like looked at the books of like what he would like to draw. And you were the one who found strange, right? I mean, this is as far as my memory goes.
I think I had that giant, you know, the one we keep bringing up all the time, that giant omnibus. I was like, what about Adam Strange?
I put my arms
like as lame as it sounds, that is the extent of how it all came to be. The magic was the next day when Tom showed up with like the complete 12 issue thing all wrapped up and he's pitching it to me.
That's amazing. You already had it? Like you were like, okay, I got it. I know how
literally overnight.
Here it comes.
If you put me in a box, I'll figure my way out. Except this actual box. I'm in now.
Right. There's no escape from this box.
There's no. Here I am, Steph.
I'm cool about to, you know, 55 minutes from now.
Yeah. So Mitch said Adam Strange, and then I was with Mitch, so I'm sure we were drunk. So then I went home, and I was drunk by myself. And what else are you gonna do when you're drunk by yourself except think about superheroes for 12 hours. And so in the morning over a breakfast burrito and drive-through Starbucks, I was like, all right, here's the idea. I'm gonna get a bunch of cool stuff to draw and we'll give that a doc. And then you can draw people walking down the street.
That's literally the last issue. And let me tell you something, such compelling comics, but that is exactly what issue 6 is. It is literally
the first
people walking.
Issue, the very first issue, Doc got to draw this big invasion on Ran, and I drew a bunch of hotel rooms.
Yeah.
think of the wallpaper.
Oh, and also a few Barnes & Nobles.
Oh, yeah, a few Barnes & Nobles. Yeah. There were signings. People were shaking hands.
Yeah, there's real compelling drama in there. You get the real human emotion in there. I mean, you got the face of the fan that I'm sure everyone's seen of, like, the dude screaming in his face, who, of course, loses his head. No pun intended. That's pretty incredible art there. But you know, yeah. So, you know, not to discount it. There's some cool shit everyone gets to draw.
There's an amazing part of issue 1 that I still laugh about. There is, I believe it's the news ticker underneath the shot of the guy with his head completely blown off.
Yeah.
I wish I had it next to me, but the news ticker says something like, man hospitalized or something like that. He doesn't have a head.
Like technically they took him to the hospital, I guess. Yeah. Put that. That's funny.
Wait, time out. What is your screensaver back there, Mitch? It's Black Cat and Catwoman.
Yeah, Adam Hughes.
That's an Adam Hughes, man. That's dope.
Oh man, you gotta be cooler than me. I get it. See, he's drinking now. This is where it all started.
Jeez. This is why panels after 10.
Yeah,
no good.
10 p.m. Jesus.
So I had always wanted to work with Doc, and I did an issue of Green Lantern way back in the day, and it was my favorite issues I've ever done. Still one of my favorite issues I've ever done. And I always wanted to work with him again, and I was looking to slowly peel away from Mitch. So I was like, I'm gonna do this transition thing, and before you know, Mitch notices, it'll be out the door. And so
I could never quit you.
I couldn't quit you either, man. So X-Men or what do you want? I had a vague idea of someone had sent me literally a tweet, and it said, Tom King just writes comics to cover up his war crimes. That's a mean, that is a mean thing to say.
What
to
a brutal
dude.
Thing to say to someone.
And I was like, that's not what I do. But fuck, it would have been so cool if that's what I did, right? That would be a really weird thing to do. Be like, yeah, if I just wrote this book to cover up my war crimes, I was like, damn, that's a good idea. Thank you, mean Twitter guy, for making me a ton of money.
you showed me again, got me again.
When the Adam Strange movie comes out, I'm sure I'll tweet back, thank you to you, and that'll be your donation. So I turned a mean tweet into this wonderful series. It's the best looking book on the shelf with these two brilliant gentlemen.
Easily, yeah. Mitch, your designs for the characters, iconic, yet also like has this gritty realism to it. How do you get into the mindset of drawing like real people in this fashion?
I mean, that's kind of like what I like.
What you're known for, like what you do. Yeah. Yeah.
There's just something like that I love about superheroes, but it makes it cooler when they feel real and they don't feel like cartoons on paper. So that's the only thing I have in my head, I guess, when I come up with my style.
Right on. You don't want to lose those cats. That's keeping people here, trust me.
I didn't want the distracting zippity-doo-dah in the background.
Sure, sure. I don't think it's pretty dynamic. And then Evan gives us this this incredible like kind of idealized version of the history of Adam Strange and this superheroics. We got like a picturesque kind of like it's everything you remember. It's like you guys play video games? I assume you do. You're probably in your 30s.
Definitely in my 30s.
So
I just got done playing a huge game of Number Munchers.
No, I'm saying like because you know if you grew up in the 80s, 70s, you definitely play video games at some point. But like I'm thinking about the updated version of the Ocarina of Time and how like when they put that out, it's like, oh, that's how I remember the game. But if you dust off your N64 and pop in the Ocarina of Time, you're like, oh, this is kind of shitty looking. Right. But
it's like when you watch any cartoon from your childhood and you're like, ooh.
Literally. You're like watching Thundercats. You're like, that intro is fire. And then you're like, oh, no.
That's right.
So, but Shaner, man, it's like you remember the heroes, but in today's like kind of like expectations, it's just this beautiful like idealized. Who better to do an idealized version of what really happened in the Pictan-Ranian War than somebody who can give you an idealized version of like, you know, your superheroes? And it's just dope, man.
Well, thanks, man.
is that the idea? Is that the? I'm sorry. That turned into me just kind of jerking you off, and I didn't mean to do that. I'm sorry. I really meant to just
keep
be
going.
Like, yeah. Which is like, yeah, you asked me why I draw real people, but you fucking, yeah, I'm sorry.
40 minutes left, and I want more.
Yeah. My question is simply, is that your kind of approach? Is just kind of like
Zelda?
Yeah, yeah. Zelda, right? Is giving you the real Ocarina?
Oh, behind the scenes.
Oh, no.
Oh, look at that.
Sits on the house all the time.
Yeah.
What a nerd. Don't look at my dog.
I was going to say, who said that? Was the person with the Luke Skywalker action figure on the shelf?
It's old Luke, so it's ironic.
Yeah.
It's ironic. That's good. So this has gone off the rails. Let's talk about what do you guys want to talk?
It's Shaner's fault. He's just like interrupting us.
No, yeah, right. He won't shut
up.
This
is exactly what a Tom King panel is like. So this is bringing back good memories.
I'm so glad to hear.
There's so many less fucks than the usual Tom King panel.
Start the counter. But yeah, man. So Strange Adventures.
Strange incredible. Adventures.
Yeah. Strange Adventures. It's the book we're talking about. You guys make it. It's great. So
and we're such goofballs and we make such sad
it really like
books.
This is gonna set we are selling so many issues of Strange Adventures like this looks like fun. Oh no, let's talk about dead children, please, come on, man. But no
dead children.
Oh, you don't read the text. I just draw.
Are there dead children in this book?
Doc only reads his side of the book.
I haven't seen any.
It's all going well, Adam.
Yeah, it's just big lizards and stuff. I don't know, man. But yeah,
it's interesting that you say Doc is like the idealized version because his side is getting grittier and grittier.
See, okay, thank
as
you.
Go forward.
I've noticed that because I reread the entire six issue series over the last like 4 hours. And I was like, and I noticed as I was going, I'm like, it's getting less pretty, but more real. And is that deliberate? Are you deliberate, like bridging the two styles together? And it seems like that's actually what you're doing.
Well,
yes, let's hear the master plan.
This is all planned, of course.
They don't call him the doctor for nothing.
They don't. And still nothing.
But Doc got the big sex scene. Doc is got the big war scene.
Mitch got the first sex scene, though.
Oh, yeah, there's multiple sex
contractually
scenes.
I must have first write a first sex scene refusal.
That's in his rights. Actually, my contract, not even his. It's like, you must write it. What? This has nothing to do with me. And they're like, it's in the...
No, you got to do it, man.
And for Clay, it's like six sex scenes. So, back at what is. So Doc's side is, it starts out as a little ideal, but it starts to drift in to show sort of what happened to Adam, sort of as he went from the start of this war to the end of the war, which is where Mitch's stuff sort of picks up. Because the big transition, who Adam is, happens in the Doc pages.
Right, right. Well, because I've been getting this impression that the Doc part is the book and the Mitch part is the real. Is that fair to say, or are we kind of getting some kind of like bridge between the two? I don't know if I'm trying to spoil the book here or not. I hope I'm not. I'm just kind of getting some insight, but I really don't want to ruin it because you got to go read this book if you haven't already. Of course you are. It's a critical darling. It's like one of the top Black Label books out there. Come on. But that being said,
goddamn Murphy verse. Well,
they keep putting out these Black Label books, which by the way are all excellent, and you should pick it up. But
I think the idea started that way, but I think we kind of evolved it as we went along.
Yes, because this book is very much trying to be, I mean, I have all of my highfalutin ideas that I always tell artsy fartsy bullshit, but I really just, when I get the art for this book, I realize that this is just an opportunity to show off what the two masters can do at the top of their game.
Right.
And so if I was to say to Doc, like, let's just do this sort of idealized, you know, classic stuff, I think we'd be putting him in a box that wouldn't be fair. Like, he has so many more gears than that in terms of his design and his ability to approach emotions and to be sexy and to be cool and to be bloody and all that shit. So like, my job here is to show you how incredible Shaner and Gerads are, and I'm doing my best.
So you take him out of the box, you put me in nine boxes.
That's right.
It's so hard to write a conversation in three boxes. I get out Darwin's stuff, and I was like, how did he do that where someone has a conversation in three boxes? It still confuses me. It's hard to get any back and forth when you're just like, except to do it like, you know, like Bendis does, where you do stacked panels. But then the dialogue is so fast, it starts to read like that old 40s, you know.
Yeah.
A stupid 40s comedy dialogue. It doesn't read right. So when I have to do like a lot of dialogue scenes, I put in a few more things.
Now, do you have to refine your dialogue? Because I feel like there are some who specialize in dialogue where they just go like, I got the scene, bam, and then here it is. But like, you know, it seems like every word is kind of very carefully chosen. I'm not putting anybody out. I'm just saying, like, there's a lot of, you know, a lot of people started to do that, you know, over the last like 20 years or so. But there's a lot of dialogue in actually all the books now that I think about it, but it seems like, I don't know, I guess does it take you a long time to kind of like ratchet out exactly what they're saying? Because I feel like this is a very deliberate book. Every stroke of the pen, every click of the typewriter or keyboard, so to speak, is very deliberate and very precise. Is that your assessment as well? Or is it kind of like, no, I wrote this scene like as it's supposed to be, and you know, it takes...
A little unknown fact is that Tom does all his narrating audibly to a Teddy Ruxpin.
They only do it like
transcribes it.
Yeah, I feel bad for that intern.
You know, now that I have the children at home and they never fucking leave, they come into my room at all hours. And when I do dialogue, I read it out loud in stupid voices.
Do you really?
So, yeah, I'll be there and you know, I'll be like, "Oh, Adam," you know, and they'd be like, "What the fuck is that doing at the computer?" So, you know, if I do gruff for, you know, I'll do like all these stupid, what my children will laugh at me in the background, be like, this is what you do for a living. Mom's lawyer. I don't really show up. Man. Just show up. All right. I have two gears of dialogue and I'm trying to lose one of them. Okay. For the project Mitch and I have done, starting with Sheriff, it's a much more naturalistic dialogue. It's a much more, things can wander. People will say things that don't actually make sense. It's not sort of the sort of reflective dialogue. When I do high superhero stuff, and I don't do this, but I can switch into that sort of Gilmore Girls, Sorkin, Bendis, like where every sentence reflects the sentence before it, and it's kind of clever, you know?
Sure.
I always think of Gilmore Girls like, oh man, it's a nice coffee. You like coffee? Yeah, I love the coffee. I got a big coffee. You do. And so that word coffee just starts dribbling down into the dialogue and becomes jokes. And yeah. I can do that dialogue, but I'm trying to throw that out as like, because I like the stuff we did more in Mr. Miracle and Sheriff and now here, where it's much more naturalistic. It's much more. It's much weirder. It's more that, yeah.
Yeah,
I like that better.
Well, because I was gonna say, I was talking to my wife about this book. I guess when issue 6 dropped, and I was mentioning that like there was the last issue felt very natural. It felt like a really like. It felt like a real conversation between two people, but there was a line in there where I was like, that felt like I'm writing a book. And she was like, and she vehemently disagrees with me. She's like, no, people would, Alana said that to get power over Mr. Terrific in this scene. And of course, once again, talking to my wife every time, I'm like, oh, I'm a dummy. Thank you for reminding me. But it feels like that's exactly what you're like, where it feels like it's natural, but then you read it again. And you're like, oh, like you're really, you know, you're taking your shots with this dialogue, and of course it's punctuated by the art in such an incredible way. I'm trying really hard not to be like, yeah, so the writing's great, right, you guys? Like, you guys are like, yeah, and I drew a cool lizard man and it was really dope, and he got killed by a helmet. It was really cool.
And we the word for it. I've never read it.
I wouldn't know.
And we do, I do, you know, I write and the Doc side of it gets a different kind of dialogue. I mean, I use exclamation points and I use bold words. I use bold words and exclamation points on one side and I don't use on the other side. Oh. So you're getting if you read, it's like a little subtle thing, but it's much more, even the lettering that Clayton does is much more comic booky. Even the shape of the bubbles is different if you look closely.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's two different dialect styles for both sides of the book. Hmm.
I love, Mitch, your design for Mr. Terrific. It like reminds me of what I know Mr. Terrific to be, but it's just like for some reason there's some subtle differences that you've kind of infused into there. Particularly his jacket is one of my favorite things about Mr. Terrific's design. It's cool. When he shows up in my side of the book, it's gonna be even better though. I
mean, if really the only thing I've been redesigning on this book is putting them in normal clothes.
Yeah.
The costumes, I don't think. Like even Adam's costume, which has the new little side runners and stuff, that was an Evan thing, I think.
Mm.
And then Mr. Terrific, I just kind of, from what I knew of Mr. Terrific.
Right. Okay. The sequence in which Mr. Terrific is staying on Ran is one of the most memorable for me in like recent readings, just because of the mundanity of what's occurring, and yet how like you there's subtle moments where you're like, oh right, you're on an alien planet, and it's like, and it's in a hostile world, and there's like this undercurrent of hostility that I really enjoy from your pencil work. That's just like,
well, my thing about that issue that I love is that when Tom originally pitched, I know this is what's going to happen with Adam and Alana and all this, and then they're going to bring in someone to foil it, to investigate him, and it's going to be Mr. Terrific. I was like, who? Like, you know,
I had the list. Guy. I just pressed the wrong arrow. He was right after
Adam. He's the most popular superhero, right?
And Tom's like, you know, the guy's got the T on his head, and he's got the balls that fly around him, and his jacket that says Fair Play on the sleeve.
He's got three balls.
Can we come up with someone better? And I was really not into it. And
no kidding.
The second issue is when I was like, oh, holy shit. No, I get what Tom's doing. But then the fourth issue, I was like, he's the most badass character in the whole DC universe.
Yeah. Yeah. I never really, I got it, but I never felt it until I'm reading Strange Adventures.
Like, exactly. Like I read him in other things, but he always seemed like, no offense to things in the past, but he just seemed kind of
lame.
Blase, sure. Another character that's there.
that's more the art than the writing, I feel like.
Yeah.
Well, I feel bad because like he always like kind of like ends up being relegated to the side or to the back, and it's only like the hardcore like Earth 2 fans that are like, what? Mr. Terrific's the best. He's smarter than Batman. And it's like, yeah, well, you know who's more profitable than Mr. Terrific? Batman. And this is the only book where you get away.
Adam Strange.
Adam Strange. Adam Strange, who's like a second fiddle in his own book. But like you get this is the opportunity for Batman to play second fiddle to Mr. Terrific. And you get to really highlight like who this guy is and what he's all about. Apparently he's a Columbo fan. I don't know whose idea that was to give him this little like that little gesture, that little just one more thing gesture, but it was very Peter Falk. I don't know who to applaud for that, but it was incredible.
That's a Mitch thing.
It was me, but channeled through how much Columbo Tom had been watching. So it was kind of a bridge thing.
I got such sad Columbo news today, guys. I'll tell you offline.
Oh, I don't want to hear it. Because Peter Falk's been gone low these, like, what?
Yeah, it turns out he was alive and died again. It was, no.
Yeah. That would be very sad. But, yeah.
Yeah, I never thought about that. I thought it was like a kind of a chill kind of thing. Oh, it was a Columbo thing.
I got kind of the one more thing vibe out of it. But I hear you. Yeah.
No, that's you fucking smart. I love that. That's awesome.
I mean, I'm sure. Well, listen, I don't know. You guys fucking wrote it. What do you want from me? But it's a dope book. I know I'm just like kind of fanboying out now. I'm sorry. It's a very comfortable. It's a very comfortable vibe you guys have created here.
I love this book. It's done. I've written the whole thing.
Okay.
All 12 issues
it is done. All right.
It is done. It's in the can. I know how it ends. It's all sunshines and lollipops and rainbows everywhere. So it's going to be, it's all happy. So
how about the, how far along are you gentlemen on the issues? Like, because Tom can write it.
Issue 7 right now. So we got to that point where as we finish issues, all of a sudden they're like in our hands 2 weeks later, which is scary and frightening and terrifying. but then we have a skip month because the director's cut comes out after 7. Wait, after 6. So the next issue for fans right now will be the director's cut. And then the next month will be 7. So we get an extra month in there to catch back up.
Oh, good. What goes into the depiction on the covers? Because the covers are not just a cool version of what happens in the pages. It's something else. Like it's a visualization of the theme of the book. Where does the process go for that to develop the covers for each issue? Because I know you get like 2 covers for the price. You always get like a Mitch and a Doc cover.
We've kind of volleyed that back and forth from the beginning. There's been a few issues where Mitch comes up with the core idea and then I kind of come up with a spin on it and vice versa. And I don't know. We haven't written it down or anything like whose idea each one was, but I think we're pretty even now at this point.
Sweet.
I think so. Yeah. But like, it all boils down to like when our editor says, we need a cover. And then Evan and I get on Messenger and we're like, well, who has an idea? Whoever has the idea wins. And then the other person has to figure out their side of it.
Has this been done before? Like the idea that 2 covers that talk to each other for 12 issues? I feel like
it sounds pretty revolutionary when you mention it out loud. So.
Yeah, I mean, this comic flows so well. I feel like people, or at least even I forget that it's very comic booky hard to do, to put 2 different artists, 2 different time periods, and have it all talk to each other and converge. It's very, the way these guys work together, I think, to me, is totally unprecedented.
I completely agree. It's
crazy
synergy.
How, like, I think it's a different experience both doing and reading the book for me and Evan than it is even for Tom. Because
Evan and I draw anything. It's easy. That's like a totally different experience, guys. It's fucking
totally
relaxing. But
Evan
really.
And I, not on purpose. We just both figured out this is how the best way for us to do it is. We just delete the other person's pages from the script we get, and mm-hmm. so, like, I see the art when Evan turns it in, but I don't see the dialogue or anything until mm-hmm. I actually read the book. So it's like I get this cool experience of both creating my favorite comic and then also like reading it like a new reader each time it comes out.
And I purposely didn't do those very sort of Alan Moore-ish transitions where you can be like, I don't know, where Adam Strange is like, you know, he tells his wife, he's like, you're the rock in my life, and then Doc draws a big rock in the next panel.
Right.
Like, stealing from Jaime Hernandez, where he does sort of like transitions that are completely random, and he'll go like 3 years in the future in the middle of a page. I read it, I was like, I love how he does this. Yeah, it's completely, there's no transitions. The audience has to make the transition. I mean, that's what's fun about comics is the audience makes the transition in their head. So if it just comes together, which often it does, where the two panels are talking to each other, it's just the kismet and the power of the comics guys. Yeah.
So with respect to the future of, no, I'm sorry. I'll save that for later. What I want to ask is, did you always envision this to be a black label book, or were you thinking like, they could probably get away with not making this black label? No, we probably should.
It was originally not a black label book.
Yeah, originally not.
And then DC changed their structuring of what black label is.
Right.
And so there became much stricter rules to have a DCU book than a black label book. And we didn't want to change our vision at all. So we just said, yeah, we'll do it black label.
Right. Do you find that's an option now that was before closed to you? Like that there's or you're like, you know, we could do this book. We could probably get it within the confines of like a mainstream kind of title, or we could probably at this point get away with going over here and doing more of what we want to do. And is that true that you can get away with more, or is it just a different kind of environment where there's the same amount of restrictions just in different form?
Yeah, that for sure. It's like, it's weird because they didn't really make it super clear to fans, I don't think, but like what Black Label started out as and what it is now is like a completely different thing.
Yes.
They changed their rating systems, and Black Label's just their new rating system for that, mm-hmm. you know, whatever. So like, what is it? DC Kids, DC Comics, and Black Label, I think.
Right.
And each one comes with very strict sets of rules, so.
Sure. Any other, any insights on that from the rest of the panel, or should we move on?
No, I mean,
As there's, I know there's stuff on my side that wouldn't have flown outside of Black Label.
Mm.
Because.
So your stuff didn't fly inside Black Label.
Is that true? Were there things that they had to, that they were like, no?
I've only had one thing that had to be kind of configured after I turned it in.
The sex scene got cropped.
The sex scene got cropped, yeah. There's a sexier sex scene.
It was at the full page? Was it the full splash in the cave?
Yeah, and it's all mine now.
Adam Hughes' screensaver.
I don't know. I think that's moving on. So I was gonna say, well, it doesn't seem like there's much to crop it. There it's the two bodies. Like, what are you gonna what else is there?
Butts.
Butts. There you go.
Specifically less Adam butt, because our editor said we used our butt quota on my Mr. Terrific shot.
Thanks.
We ran over our amount of butts.
So it's one. So the glass ceiling on butts in Black Label is a butt. Okay. Oh, I see. Oh, see, now that's interesting. That could be a different measuring system. Like one male butt, one full male ass is the equivalent of what in other you know, more uncensored terms. I don't know.
We had more butts in Mr. Miracle, didn't we? I feel like we had a good amount of butts. Yeah.
Maybe they noticed and they were like, that's too many. We can't have Mr.
Miracle that got censor word.
Oh, sure.
Oh, that's true. You're not allowed to pee on people in comics.
Nope, that one. And...
that's only in politics.
I don't know what you're talking about.
That scene where Scott comes downstairs to find Funky and all the guards waiting for him.
Yes.
He comes down completely naked. Originally, there were no Kirby dots.
Ah. you know, it's funny, though, I find, and I'd like to hear everyone's opinion on this one, that, you know, sometimes restrictions and adversity breed a different kind of creativity that you never would have found otherwise.
Completely.
Do you find that, like, in the moment, it's like, ugh, editorial again, but then when you climb out of that box, you're like, oh yeah, I'm kind of cool with that. Like the Kirby crackle, for example, that's a really cool effect, and it really like it punctuates Mr. Miracle. Without it, you know, you get something else. It's just it's not as thematic.
We've been working with Jamie from Sheriff on. Like Jamie's been my only editor since I started at DC, and God, if he's watching right now, I'll never hear the end of it. Every single note I've ever got from Jamie ended up being one for the positive, like after I cooled down.
Yeah.
On Rorschach, we just had to make the decision. I guess they call them growlixes. I don't even know what the fence, but the like pound symbols you put over swear words for fucks and shits.
Yes.
I kind of love them in comics. I think it's even more powerful to have like pound fuck you instead of just saying fuck you. Like fuck blows me off. And it makes the fuck louder in your head somehow to see it blocked off. It's like that beep or something.
Yeah.
In Rorschach, we sort of noticed, you know, there were some things we were blocking and some things we weren't. We had this like whole the most absurd conversation. Like, okay, so shits don't get growlixes, but fucks do. What about ass? Is ass? And they know. And so eventually they're just like, no, Tom, we're just pulling it all down. You can say fucking shit as much as you want, which obviously I can say as much. But I do miss it when I read the book now. I was like, why are these people swearing so much? Just little potty mouths.
Yeah, it's funny when you're watching, like when you find out like certain radio stations have eased up on certain restrictions and TV show as well, where you're like, wait a minute, whoa, look, we're in a different world here. You know, you can't just do that, can you? Could we always do that? Ah, riot! Like, it's with comics, I do agree with the pounds and the, you know, it is more bold. It draws attention to it in a way that having regular language kind of doesn't. But yeah. So, all right, I guess we can ask some questions. People have a lot of questions in the chat. I don't know. I mean, like, we
are watching this?
Right? Well, not for long. Not if I have anything to say about it, I'll tell you that.
I want something other than a Batman shirt.
All right, here we go. Well, Kyle says, just wondering what your favorite characters are. This is for Doc to draw on Future Quest. Loved your work on that series, Hanna-Barbera Forever. What were some of your favorite characters to draw?
Thank you, Kyle. Space Ghost. That was the one going in that I was most excited about. It was the drawing a Space Ghost book is not a thing that I ever thought would be even a choice. So,
yeah,
Space Ghost, Birdman, Johnny and Race, of course, but Dino Boy. But, all across. I loved all of them.
Yeah.
We have weird jobs.
Right? It's cool. It's really cool.
Space Ghost, Dino Boy.
Dino Boy, yeah. Peter says, my big love question for Doc, what's it like to join up with the two guys that have a relationship from working together for a while? What was turning that duo into a trio like?
Well, first off, let's not call it a relationship.
Oh,
it's a throuple.
break my heart, Doc.
I knew both to be these in guys from before. So, I mean, I've known Mitch for over a decade now, and I've known Tom since we worked on Green Lantern together five or six years ago, I think. Now,
I walked up at some con. I don't know. It feels like Heroes. I like ran up to your table and said, "Do you want to do Green Lantern?" And you're like, yeah.
Right, yeah.
And that was like how we fucking did it.
Yeah.
That's what cons used to be awesome. I remember.
Yeah, those were those. Remember when those used to happen? We're at one right now, but it's not the same. You can't run over. I can't go anywhere. This is actually the first time I've been able to reach any of your booths. By the way, is right now. So thank you.
So I got my ticket to get in.
Doc, do you want to do Green Lantern
again? Yeah. Don't say that too loudly. The internet will freaking lose their minds. Oh, new Black Label 12 issue series. All three of these guys again. If
don't bring me in on this.
No. I want to see that. I want to see your Kilowatt. You know you'll enjoy it. It's fine. Do you? Oh, Andrew says a question for Tom. If you could write a world in the DC multiverse, which one would you choose?
Oh God! I guess why get the hard questions? There's 52 of those things.
Just pick a number,
at least.
Yeah, a 37. That's the one I like.
Yep.
We all know 37, right? And watch it. It's like the Nazi world. Like, no, it's not about right now.
Please let it be the Red Sun world.
All right, I'm looking it up right now. Go ahead.
I you know what comes to my head, and this is a stupid answer, but one of my favorite scenes in all of comics, this is a lot of people say, but the end of Kingdom Come, we're in that restaurant and they have that conversation.
Oh.
I just love that scene, and I would like to write just like the sequel to it. So put me in the Kingdom Come world and put me in a restaurant and give me some more characters having
lunch. Dude.
And I would have a good time.
Have you seen, you must have, because you are Tom King, but have you seen that image, I think, that Alex Ross did, where it's kind of like a sequel that like shows you Superman through the ages after Kingdom Come? Like, it's just like...
Yes, I have seen that. It's beautiful.
The only sequel I will accept from Kingdom Come is just that page, where you're just like, yes! It's just so incredible. That Batman funeral? Oh, anyway. By the way, Earth 37 is one of the 51 divergent realities. Batgirl and Robin fight a female Joker in the 60s, while Detective Bruce Wayne becomes the Batman after Robin's death. So I don't know what the hell that is, but it sounds ripe for some
Tom King. That is a goddamn classic, man.
Yeah, first appeared in Thrill Killer number 1 in 1997.
Oh, the costumes are dope. I know that cover, the pulp...
That's the one!
Cover, yeah.
By Dan Brereton.
Oh man, nice. You gotta nerd me up. You gotta show me. I gotta one up me. Fucking
that's called a layup. You see, you tossed it, boom.
Oh, that's right. I had the assist.
Jay Park says, "I'm an aspiring cartoonist, and you guys are my idols. Is there any advice you could give for both writing and drawing on doing a maxi series? Thank you."
Start smaller.
Yeah, why maxi? Why not?
Eight page.
What's the key to a maxi series? I feel like I do these things all the time,
right?
Maxi series are they're easier, I think, than as someone who did 85 issues of Batman. To me, they're easier because they have a beginning and a middle and the end. So when you come up with the pitch and the original idea, you actually know where you're going and you can just aim your plot in that direction. As for advice on how to do it, yeah, pick your favorite movie, you love it, and then imagine it with superheroes and see if it works.
Oh, that's like, actually not bad.
It's a good place to start. And that's like that's old. Like when I first started, I got like John Gardner's book on how to write. It's like the most famous book on how to write. And he wrote Grendel, right? So that's like he's like, if you can't think of anything else to write, steal from someone else. I stole Grendel from ancient and I just modernized it. So like that's kind of thing. Like go back and find something that really appealed to you when you were young and see what that structure and see if you can apply that structure in a modern way. Kind of.
That's fair. I think that's a nickel's worth of free advice. Gentlemen, as far as Evan and Mitch, what advice would you give to aspiring artists on who want to start and work on a series?
I think the thing, like, my favorite thing to tell, like, new young artists is get really good at backgrounds.
Mm.
Because nobody else is doing, everybody wants to draw Spider-Man doing a kickflip, you know, some big splash play. But, like, if you can draw Peter Parker sitting in a kitchen, you're way more likely to get that job than you are the other way.
Yeah.
Yep. Tagging off what Mitch said, just people sitting.
People sitting.
Well, you'd be surprised how many of these artists know how to draw some kind of splashy pinup type thing, but have no idea how to draw, one, a chair, two,
right,
someone sitting in that chair.
Yeah.
I don't know how to do it.
But I have drawn a ton of sitting in the series.
Right.
So
Well, the all sitting issue is next.
It's gonna be great. What's the hardest thing to draw now? Because I've heard some of the hardest things to draw: horses, cars. But what are some things that challenge you both to draw today? Where you're like, oh Christ, you put this in the book. Here we go, and then you have to challenge yourself.
I want to know the answer.
My thing is a lot of characters in one.
Oh,
shot.
Just like fill the room. Yeah.
Yeah. Just because I'm so obsessed with like Norman Rockwell, and to me, each character could be doing something and have a reason for how they're standing and what they're doing. And when I have to do that to 20 different characters, I don't know how to do it.
Right. That sounds like a self-imposed restriction as opposed to a generic issue.
Yeah, but that's true. I mean,
but that's fair.
Get paid.
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah. Doc?
I mean, again, going off what Mitch said, that issue 6 was tough, drawing all the war scenes on Ran. It was fun. It was really rewarding, but it was tough. It was a grind.
I remember when I first got it, when I first turned in, you're like, okay, I'm going to do some close-ups of guns and stuff and use a little few cheats. And then you use none of the fucking cheats.
I know.
And you just decided, you're just like, no, I'm just going to draw the whole war.
I'm an idiot.
Was that you being like, no, I'm not using the training
wheel. I can do this.
I can do, don't give me the handicap. Actually, apropos of that, Goth I Am, why did, or actually I would posit that as like, did issue 5's cover change? The preview showed Adam's face different to the final cover.
It's a mask.
It didn't change. Okay. This is a Berenstain Bears thing, and you're all remembering.
They slid.
Yep.
Fair enough.
Adam's against mask wear, and he took.
Oh shit.
He's a real asshole.
Yeah, Adam's an anti-masker.
Yes, Adam's an anti-masker. That's my fault, actually. Doc drew this beautiful mask page, and it didn't make it into the book, so he took it out.
Ah.
And but we put it in later. There's I love the mask design, so it comes in later. Yeah.
Sweet.
Doc did a whole like 90s Kenner line of Batman thing where. There's all like I'm sure it'll be in the collected edition, but there's like 20 different costumes for Adam. It's Scuba Adam and Jungle Adam and Night Strike Adam.
That's awesome. Adam.
Tropical Thunder Adam.
I see a question in here that I really dig, and I just want to hear your opinions about this one. From Ricardo, he says, "What is a comic you love that seemingly nobody else does?"
Batman Run.
Oh no, that was brutal.
I got my Lee Weeks fucking trade today. It's good. I read it. I fucking wrote that good, man. Well, we're fud shit and fucking dirty stuff. Good. And y'all river with the I am looking at my wall of stuff I love. I like William Messner Loeb's Flash better than Mark. Well, I like Mark Waid as a person, but I like William Messner Loeb's Flash better. Oh. I think I'm the only person in the world who says that. Maybe. I like that. I like that middle version of the Wally Flash that goes from like issue 12 to issue 57 or something.
Hmm. I'm not familiar with Loeb's Flash. I'm only familiar with his Wonder Woman and Max. That's where I know him from.
Oh, yeah, I love that stuff. I also have Challenge of the Unknown, the first Loeb and Sale series. I mean, Bendis also loves this, so I feel like I'm not unique in this, but we that's like one of my favorite books of all time, and nobody ever talks about it. It's like the first Loeb Sale joint.
I'm shocked we haven't gotten the Challenge of the Unknown from you yet. I feel like that's like almost here. Like that's like 2023.
I have trouble doing books where someone's already done it perfectly. I feel like they did that book. They did as
yeah.
That same with Legion of Superheroes. Like if I did Legion of Superheroes, it would just be Keith Giffen's Legion of Superheroes. Yeah, I did Keith Giffen.
Yeah. Mitch, Doc, any of your favorite books from from in the bottom of the barrel, or the barrel bottom of the long box?
All of mine are such crowd pleasing hits. I don't know.
Yeah, same. I just have
such great streamers, man.
Yeah.
I just have such great taste that
you make people change your taste.
What about your hipster? Yeah. Your hipster pick? You're like, oh, nobody reads this one.
I mean, I love all of Nexus. Steve Rude and Mike Brand's Nexus.
Okay.
Doesn't get talked enough about.
No. Of course, you never hear about
Mike Baron has become problematic, but other than that.
Sure. Oh, I like this one from, unless Evan, you're still thinking of yours.
No, I don't have one.
Nah.
Sorry.
Pass.
You could say Heroes in Crisis. There's still another one out there.
Oh. Sorry. Uh-huh. I meant Tom Kong's Heroes in Crying.
Heroes in Crying.
Josu, I don't know how to say that. I'm sorry. Says, who struggles with more with deadlines, Mitch or Evan? I don't think that's fair. But I'm going to leave it in the air.
We tend to turn things in pretty much at the same time.
Yeah. We're both old dudes with kids, so.
So you're home.
About the same.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Mitch has less kids than you, so fuck him, right?
Yeah.
Like, he has no kids. He should be much faster.
I have a cat.
I have a cat.
Never mind. I think I said anything. Uh-huh.
Well, we're winding down, so I wanted to see if we could tease a little bit about what's to come for Strange Adventures without giving anything away. What are you most excited about? Coming around the bend for Strange Adventures.
I'm excited about the pages I've been doing in number 7.
Yeah, like seven. Something's happening.
Yeah, they're really pretty.
Sweet.
Mitch asked for more action, so there's a lot of action in the Mitch. They're super cool. What's happening is we've gotten halfway through, and I think sort of we had the big twist at the end of 6, where everyone sort of thought. One person was the bad guy, and maybe that person wasn't the bad guy, and so now the camera's looking around for who the real bad guy is, and of course the whole mystery comes out and is revealed by issue 12 of sort of what happened in the past, and how did that affect Doc's and how did that affect Adam Strange, and can Mr. Terrific figure this out before the Picks destroy the world?
Right.
One of the bigger mysteries of the book gets answered in issue 7.
Ooh.
Oh yeah. Yeah, that's true. One of the bigger issues. Yeah, each issue after each issue 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, they all have big reveals in them. Each one is like, whoa, holy crap. Okay. So we're sort of elevating as we go forward. Yeah.
Nice. That's exciting. Keeping up the momentum and getting people excited, because like there's nothing like thinking, oh geez, we're halfway through, we got another it's gonna have the same build as the last 6, and then it's like 7, 8, 9, you're like, oh shit, it's happening. So that you're just ramped up. Of course, we're taking a month, so I guess issue 7 drops what, in December?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe?
Yeah, it's like December 1st. It's early December, yeah.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Sweet. Well, I guess that's that. I want to thank you guys so much for hanging out. And before
you
we
sound
do
exhausted.
Go. I know. I will, you know.
Have you been doing this all day?
No, I have not. It's actually my first show, but
we exhausted you.
Oh, no, I just feel I just I'm like I think Tom, you made this comment on another show we did where you were just, it just feels like I'm Chris Farley being like, so you guys remember when you drew this awesome thing? That was awesome.
I have to interview Dave Gibbons on Sunday. So, yeah.
just ask him about Batman versus Predator. He loves that book.
Yeah. Oh, I'm asking about Batman versus. It's a good Batman versus Predator.
Yeah.
My kid read it and got legit scared. Like I can't sleep because I read Batman versus Predator. I was like, good.
That's good.
That means you read a good book. That's well done.
Let it affect you.
Where can everybody find you and follow you? We'll start with Doc.
At Doc Shaner on Twitter.
Nice. Mitch?
You can find me in my office, but don't follow me.
Now you tell me? I'm outside!
At Mitch Gerads, Twitter, Instagram, Homing Pigeon.
Nice.
I'm at Tom King TK on Twitter, and then I'm at Tom King underscore TK just to throw you motherfuckers off.
The gram.
On the gram.
Well, thank you guys so much, and thank you for just an incredible book. It's such a good series. You guys, if you haven't picked up Strange Adventures, you must. It's just, it's a must buy. And it comes out every month. The minimum commitment is 12 months. That ain't bad. Pick it up. Thanks for being here, and we'll see you guys with the next show.
Thank you. This was so much fun. I really appreciate it. You're
awesome. Oh, my pleasure. All my pleasure. Thank you, gentlemen.